Elias died. Helen brought her back to him, back from the grave. Right.
Wow, did we really fail our checks? You know, we thought it was a guy the whole time.
And... Yeah. Surprise.
Guys, I described him when he came into the game that he had long blonde hair and, you know, giant breasts. But all in all, he was back. You guys took a very quick rest. You couldn't stay around the area very long. Helena ended up scouting ahead, discovering that the villagers were being held in cages in this large kind of ritual room. And she offered to sacrifice herself, as she believed she'd already failed by bringing him back.
Before all that, there was confrontation with Pythagoras and Jordan's character, that guy. That's it.
We're good.
Antimaeus doesn't like magic. He's not pretty good with that fast. And as soon as Aelius is brought back from the dead, and Helen used some kind of ritual, and then Pythagoras also to fight the creatures used a spell, and he didn't like that very much, so he went to attempt to kill Pythagoras. You guys fought for a little bit, and then he just left, taking Jaunt.
Had a magic tantrum where they found his dog was dead.
Animation part of it. This is where Helen's skeleton ahead. Found the cages for prisoners in them. Knew that because she kind of failed her task, and that she had done her ritual to bring that guy back to life, that, you know, she believed she should have done. She was dead anyways, so she was like, I'm just going to sacrifice myself. You guys are the prisoners out of there. So that was the plan. She ran in to stop from the ritual and distract some of the cultists. You guys went in, opened up the cages, got the prisoners out, and heroically still managed to actually save Helen before she was torn apart by some kind of flesh wall of a creature. She wasn't too happy with that, but last used the laser light. So you flee from the tower with the villagers that were held captive. You all got up to the surface, and that's kind of where we're at. So to kind of recap what's going on with Aelius' situation right now, Helen explained that she is kind of a identity trait, which essentially means that she's not a full-fledged person, and this was her task to be here to protect these villagers. As one of the final steps. She, however, has been privy to witnessing the ritual, the trainee becoming a full tight end. And because she's seen this several times, she had never done this before, but she said it was expressly forbidden for someone that was not one of the four elders of the Tide End to do this ritual, and that the penalty was death. So she did this nonetheless, brought him back to life. She's not really sure why. You guys aren't really sure why it worked to bring him back to life, but it did.
And that's where you guys are at right now.
She said that his new designation, Van, will actually destroy him because it is power hungry for a weakened between himself and himself. So she said that you guys should probably go to the tower and talk to them so that they can remove this title slash power before he dies.
Right.
That's where we're at.
So
you guys are the top.
At the base of the tower, you've got many villagers standing around you, kind of looking at you, saying, "What's next?"
All right, I walk away. No, I'm just kidding. Defend yourselves.
Which you can't find your way back to your own town.
All these parts.
So I'm pretty sure we're all pretty fucking destroyed. Like, I have nothing left. Yep. I'm almost dead. I'm pretty sure you're all dead. Maybe we should just take a short rest or something and then lead these guys back to town and take a long rest.
Game sucks.
I don't want to stay here too long.
I don't know how much further I can make it if anything happens between here and the village.
The village is
what if we trip? I suggest we at least go see if our cart is still here.
Oh.
Right. First, and then we can take a short rest.
I'm gonna walk around and short rest to tell the villagers see to their wounds and stuff.
Okay. None of them are too bad of shape. Most probably look like they've been battered and bruised, some of them have small cuts, but nobody was like halfway through dissection or anything else when you rescue them, luckily. So, for the most part, they're doing okay, more so scared than anything. So, you guys tend to the villagers, and you're gonna head back to the cart then?
Yeah.
Yeah. If the cart is there, we could use that to move like people like Helena and...
It wasn't too far away, was it?
Alias. No, it was just in between the woods. There's a little bit of a trail.
Yeah, there's a forest path. There's like an hour back to get back, but it's not that.
Yeah.
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 We left it on that really terrible road. We got attacked by the spiders.
Which we might not want to go back.
Now that we're back at the tower, we can go back to the main road.
Where it wasn't bumpy and shitty.
I don't know.
Can we get it through here and then take that safe road? No, we can't.
No, that's what we pretty much called the forest.
Yeah, no, the forest is too dense. Yeah.
So it's about an hour. How about everybody rest? I'll go back and check on that wagon. See if it's there. You sure?
Oh, yes, you can go.
Oh, yes, you can go talk to Animea somewhere.
Oh, yeah.
One of them.
There you go. That's a good idea.
Maybe I should do that. Have a heart to heart.
Helen, she probably can't walk on her own. She was pretty messed up when we rescued her.
She's still passed out at this point. She's very battered and bruised. Both of her arms are still dislocated.
I'll stick with her. I'll fix her up as best I can, I guess.
All right.
Healing herbs. It's like one of the few things I
put. Chew on them, spit them up, and rub it on our wounds. I don't know. I don't have any healer kits. They're all gone. So you do what you can for.
Do you want to give me a medicine check if you've got it?
I'm gonna give my very last healer's kit to Pythagoras, because I've got one use left in it.
Okay.
I guess I'll use that to tend her wounds, relocate her arms. Okay. It's pretty fucked up.
Pull the handy arm relocator out of the Oh, perfect.
Now this might pinch a little.
All right, so you tend to her. You spend a little bit of time with her. Use the healer kits to seal up some of her wounds as best you can. Apply some poultices and salves, and then pop her arms back into place as well. She doesn't really come to quite yet, but she's breathing a little bit more cleanly than she was previously. She's not gasping for air due to crushed body and that sort of thing at this point.
We get to roll a hit dice for a short rest, right?
If you have hit dice left to spend, yes.
What happens with mine?
Did you spend anything?
No.
Well, while they're gonna tend to her and all of that, I'm gonna start heading for the cart. See if it's still there or what. But I'm just going just as far as the cart.
So you're gonna head back to the cart, or the villagers are gonna want to come this way when they can take the main road.
Sorry, what was that?
Are we taking the villagers and we're all heading back to the cart, or basically just telling them? Well, there's the road.
The cart's kind of a lost cause, I think, right? I mean, we can't really take it back through that bumpy ass road full of spiders.
No, but we have two horses on there.
Yeah, and that's why you're going back there. You're just gonna grab the loot if there's any, and I guess while you're doing that, we can just kind of slowly take the villagers through back to town.
I can lead them because I am going that way. but I'm not going to be going all the way to town right now.
No. Well, we're going to go down a different route, though, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, we'll just rest.
I'd like to head back to the current, too, and grab lunch if we can, swap for one.
Right now. Alex?
Sorry, what time of day is it?
Yeah.
Sorry, what time of day is it? It's getting into kind of late.
No, they can stay here. We're not leading people in the dark.
Oh, well, I didn't know what time it was.
Yeah, I know. That's why I was like, wait a minute.
Let's set up camp.
Yeah.
I doubt the spiders would visit us tonight.
Yeah. Is Johnson out here at all? Yeah, fuck that guy.
He left it at Demaeus.
That's his problem now.
Yes.
Lost your best friend alias.
Oh man. How inconvenient.
So Eldegar,
are you gonna come to the cart
with me? Or are you gonna stay here?
Are you going tonight? Are you going tonight in the dark?
With the spiders.
If you're going, it's only an hour
and then like an hour back if we do come back. If not, I mean, we could always set up camp there too, but we'll have horses. So
maybe
have horses.
We should head and see what we can salvage at least.
Okay. All right, so the two of you are going to head there. All right, so the two of you are going to head there, and then the remainder of you will set up camp. Okay. All right. Okay.
I'm going to spend all my dice. I need some.
Yeah, I've got nothing to spend. I'm totally spent. That's why I just want to get stuff done now and then sleep.
Yeah, right. Okay.
All right, so you guys take a quick breather then. So the path with the cart is clean. There's no weird noises. Nobody meet along the path. The bodies that were kind of scraped up against the trees and partially skinned are still there.
But otherwise, nothing really of note.
After just less than an hour's journey, you arrive at the cart. There is a cart there. Unfortunately, there are no horses. And upon further inspection of the cart, while all the hard goods are there, all of the monetary goods are gone. So all the gold, all the coins, everything else is all gone.
Please tell me you guys kept the alcohol that you guys were brewing, right?
Oh, yeah, I got that on me. Probably not ready.
Lugging it all. It's...
I called Barbarian Brew. It was Almagar's idea. So.
Like is the human skin loot sack still there?
No. And when you go look for it, there is.
Wait, I do want to check that hidden compartment. Because I know we have a hidden compartment on the cart.
It's got that nice sword in it.
Opening up the hidden compartment, there is still the sword in there, but the lockbox that was in there is gone.
So I guess you should take that sword of this one. One of the ones that the right people might find offensive. What kind of sword was that? It was a longsword.
Did he take all the signet rings?
Everything that was worth anything.
The only ring I have is the one that Helen just gave me.
Do we still have the set of black armor?
Yeah.
I'd like to work on my rapier while I have time too.
What about our heavy cloaks? Are those gone?
No, sorry, they're still there. All the clothes that are really gone are like gems, gold.
What about the boots?
That sort of thing.
They're still there.
Fleshy sack, by the way, as you're moving around the cart inspecting it, is in a burning little pile.
Damn it, son of a bitch!
Because it Because it. Wow. Oh wow.
That's the line.
That's the line.
And what about my sled? Is that still in the cart?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Oh, that's something.
The dog will still be able to.
Oh yeah. That's okay. It can still be pulled by a person. It's a sled.
Didn't Pythagoras just leave his dead dog on the floor there? Didn't want to take him for a proper burial?
My dog was eaten by a out of game.
Oh,
I think
right.
is a
gibbering
right. mouther. We asked. She said that she killed them. They were dead. It was the only way to get through. I'm not going back there. No.
Right.
All right. So you guys inspect the carts. Head back to camp. Or.
Well.
This wouldn't have taken long. Not even horses.
Well, the question is, do you want to take any of the weapons that are on the cart now? Do you want to try pulling the cart back with me? I don't really think that's a good idea, but...
No. Because it was a pretty bumpy route, too.
Yeah.
Like, it was pretty rough going.
But I can hook up...
Actually,
if we put our bags together, we can hook a lot of the stuff up to the sled and pull that through. Cause it's just like a little flat sled.
Oh, right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we could do that.
Are there any hand axes in the cart?
No. There's great axes.
We're just great axes, right?
Okay.
I'll wait till I get to town.
I guess. Well, that's a shame. Wagons are hard to come by. We just have to leave it here. Oh, well.
I'm sure the town owes us something now.
I'm sure they can
arrange something for us.
As they put their lives back together, pick up the pieces.
So
you can reunite with your kids later.
Bring us back.
All right.
So remind me out of game later to tell you how much money we just lost, guys. My barbarian character has no concept of money. She just knows it was important to get. For Alex's campaign, guys, it's sad.
You just went from being really rich to
Such is the life.
Especially in this campaign. All right.
So yeah, well, I'll take off the. My sled off the back, and I'll load up what's on the cart onto the sled and pack what I can into my bag, and yeah.
I assume I'll probably need a torch by now.
Yeah.
We got a lantern in here. There's lantern and oil.
How much are you gonna try and take off the cart onto the sled?
You guys have a lot of stuff in there.
We don't have that much.
No.
No, no. That's why I said if I put some in my bag too, we can split the load. No, I guess I can erase the dog.
That's not funny.
By the way, I was looking at my character sheet, and I realized because I picked the urchin background, I got a mouse, but I forgot about it for like 12 sessions, so it's probably a dead mouse in my shirt.
Just gonna reach into your pocket.
I probably have been stinking for a while.
Oh my god, Sir Mousertons!
I totally forgot. Oh, no!
That's
hilarious.
I just see your first day as an urchin with a mouse, and you get in a fight, and it's of course crushed and killed.
Okay, so you guys are heading back to the cart then.
Yes.
Yeah, and I'll tie stuff down with rope too, because we have rope in here. I will.
All right.
You tie down the equipment to the sled. You pull it
back to
camp.
It takes you a little longer because you're pulling.
It takes you a little longer because you're pulling.
The journey seems to be fine.
The journey seems to be fine. You hear sounds.
Sorry, there is one hand axe in here.
One. Okay.
Well,
one. Okay. I'll take that. Yeah.
It was like, there's no damn hand axes.
It was like, there's no damn hand axes. And then she's like, okay.
I knew there was one somewhere.
Magical. Oh, that's magical. You know, one.
Anyways, so you guys
head through the kind of path moving by the skid bodies once again, dragging your sled.
And it takes a little bit longer than
an hour. Heading back, only because, again, the weight of the sled is behind you, but the journey seems pretty easy.
You hear some kind of
skittering and some brush and branches moving along the path, but nothing really seems to enter the sled.
All right, so you arrive back at camp.
By this point, the villagers have kind of set up, and they're all starting to light little individual fires.
Groups of like 10 or 12.
There's some people still crying about lost loved ones, and others are sitting there singing some kind of local songs, and a couple of them are trying to
do a few activities that are trying to make it feel a little better.
And by activities, I mean like dancing.
Sounds like we do some drums.
So exactly. So
that's kind of the scene right now,
and we are getting into a little bit later in the night.
I'm just gonna sleep because I need it.
All right, so Pio sleep.
Do I get
me too?
A
me too.
Dice back, or is it? Does that work again? Sorry.
Yeah.
You got half of them back?
Half your level rounded down, so it'll be one still. Yeah.
And you are able to spend.
And you are able to spend that if you wish. Let's rest.
Yeah, I'm gonna go lay down once I get back as well. I'm pretty exhausted.
Alias, you resting as well?
Yeah.
What the villagers alert us of anything?
There's enough of them. I mean, you'll hear lots of screaming before. Just set up in the middle of them all. Yeah, exactly. Nice perimeter villager fodder.
So you guys go to
Your dreams, while
Not necessarily, vivid by any means, or certainly not green. Many images flash through your mind of some of the horrors that you saw down in that tower, along with just kind of replaying a few of the moments, potentially ending a little bit differently than how they actually went,
being destroyed by one of the Wraith's or Spectres, or you being the one being torn apart by some fleshy monster as it seeds. Just this kind of stuff flashes through your dreams. Before you know it, your eyes are waking, or opening, sorry, as you wake to day just breaking through the boughs of the trees above you.
And
a lot of the villagers are getting up at this point, too. Two in particular walk up to you as they see you waking up, and they say,
Quite grateful for everything you've done.
And we don't mean to rush, but is there any opportunity that we could leave sooner than later?
We'd like to get back. Let's go out of here.
Let's go right now.
Thank you, Masters.
We appreciate it.
So these villagers kind of get what they have together, which isn't really much.
Closing their backs.
And you guys depart down the main road back to the village.
So,
So the trip from this trip to the village is a few hours, probably four or five hours later, so you guys get to mid-morning. And you arrive at the village.
Luckily, no other strange happens.
As soon as you arrive at the village, many people start dispersing from the quickness of their step as they approach their home.
How's Helen doing?
She's still unconscious. So one of the villagers had offered to her after seeing what she was doing.
How's the town looking? Any new residents here? Okay, good.
No, it's essentially in the same condition as you guys left it.
So, I mean, there's destruction on the ground, several large piles of... otherwise, it's in good shape.
Alright. Well, if everybody's all fucking settled in and good to go now, I'd like to go to the tavern.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I'd like to go to the tavern.
Yeah, sure.
We need to eat.
I'll make some food for the entire village.
With what?
With my pack of rations.
I could go for a while and set up a trap, and we could have a good dinner, but for breakfast right now, I think that's best maybe to see if they have, so no one's going to have anything to eat. Yeah, okay, I'm going to go run around outside of town. Unless you guys, because I think we should still spend a night here before we head out.
Yeah.
So if you guys go and find a... Watch this stuff. Because I... Just give you the lead to my sleigh. And I take a few things and I'm going to go run off outside of town. And I'm going to go set up hunting traps and see if I can go collect some food and such. And I take some sacks and some stuff from the group loot, and I go and do that.
While she's doing that, I'll go around to any villagers that I may know from being here and just see if they can help us out in any way, just recover from our adventures.
You
definitely identify a few that you know.
As you approach them, they look hesitant at first, and then you start talking, and one in particular kind of looks at you and says, Alias, I'm sorry I didn't recognize you.
I feel bored, we haven't really said much to any of you, you've called us so much, please don't be offended, it's just so tired, I know you've been through a lot, so have we.
More than we're used to, since you venture types. No offense taken.
I completely understand. What's this guy's name? This is John Tane.
Of the John clan.
He's related to John.
John Tane, however, is much more intelligent.
Is he also a woodcutter? No, actually, John Tane was a farmer by trade, but this area doesn't have a ton of farmland because they get most of their food from the cities. But he recently has actually gotten into running.
Oh, okay, he's running it.
He's actually the owner.
Excellent. Then I'll also throw it out, it's good to see you again, John Tane.
Any chance you could spare some food or some rooms for me and my friends?
Anything you need, stay as long as you want. Myself and a few chaps here, and with what we have, celebrations, bring up the food for everyone, to also thank you as best we can.
Thank you as best we can.
Awesome, thank
Awesome. Thank you, John. We appreciate that. We'll let us know if we can be of help getting things set up.
I will, but I would be more concerned with getting some rest.
Are we all in the same room?
Sweet. Are we all in the same room? Did everybody else do that?
Yeah, you guys are all outside together here, so outside from Maple.
Cool.
So you guys said you wanted to head to the tavern, right? So
he'll also
offer, you know, if you need some food or some drinks right now, I can certainly provide those for you. If you'll follow me to the tavern.
Sounds good.
All right. So he brings you there,
shuts the door, and then stabs.
Nice, awesome.
In all seriousness, he brings you in there. He disappears in the back for a little bit, grabs a few mugs of ale, and then he also goes to the back for an even longer period of time, prepares
some meager kind of food.
It's the, you know, some dry meats, more or less, but better than nothing, better than rations.
He apologizes and says, I'm sorry I don't mean to provide you with such a meager meal,
but
I have to reserve our good meat for the feast tonight. You won't forget that, I promise.
So I hope this sates you for now, and later we can eat like
it's fine. Anything's better than nothing right now.
And he says, with no disrespect, I will be retiring upstairs.
Quite tired still.
I wish to rest before I have to stop.
Go ahead, you big pussy. Sorry.
Don't mind him.
If there's anything I can do for you, just let me know.
Hits to the noggin.
Turns around and heads up the stairs.
He's permanently concussed.
All right, I say we share that barbarian brew. See what it tastes like. I don't want to die first.
Yes.
All right, so I'm gonna open it up.
We'll have to save some for Maple. If it's not good enough.
Yeah.
If it's not good enough, we can save some.
We'll just swap out with some of the ale that John Tane brought out for us. And be like, look what we made.
It really turned out well. Oh, yeah, I'll totally have a drink of that.
All right.
Make a constitution save for some in each of your cups.
And you're not quite sure if you're about to drink ale or syrup. It comes out quite thick, as originally pouring out, it doesn't even count. Some kind of big piece just juts through, and then all of a sudden this syrupy kind of liquid starts pouring.
But it's just a really dark, thick mead liquor, right?
So after you measure each cupful by three mugs of the barbarian's brew.
Well, who wants to drink it first?
I'm just kind of sitting here.
I'm a barbarian, but I don't usually drink brews like this.
How does it smell?
I take a big whiff, and it smells like its components,
if they had been sitting and rotting for a couple days.
I think it needs a little more water.
You're sure you see, like, corn in there? No, corn is never added to it. It's just, you know, it's a mess.
I didn't survive those horrors to be killed by
wolves.
It definitely smells like liquor, though.
It's definitely got an alcohol content to it.
Let's find, like, a villager to try it first. Is anyone in the tavern right now? Maybe we'll just. I'm gonna just leave my cup here for now. I don't want to drink that yet.
How about the other two of you?
How about the other two of you? Are you guys out for some barbarian brew?
You don't have to barbarian. This is barbarian brew. I am going to
rage.
Basically, put it to my lips enough that I can taste it.
And then I have my other drink.
And then I have my other drink chaser, that will serve me as my chaser, should I need it.
All right.
Not as bad as the smell.
Not much better. Not quite as bad. The taste in your lips could be described as tangy.
But as soon as it hits your lips,
the thing you're going to notice even more so than that is like the pure burn from the alcohol content. It's like you taste alcohol, it's like on your lips. It's like,
this is like, you know,
brain alcohol in sludge form.
I'm gonna cut a nutmeg. Is there some cheesecloth in the back here or something?
So I guess we could market it then.
There you go.
Let's sell it tonight.
Tastes better than it's.
Yeah,
you just sell it as like a work in progress ale, right? So you actually sell the cheesecloth as well, and you sell it as a feature that they get to finish making the ale.
Brain and nerve tonic. There we go.
You won't have brains.
You'll have a lot of nerves.
All right. So, Maple,
do you want to give me a survival check if you have it? That's a thing
now. 12.
So you go and you set your
hunting traps. Bait.
How many do you have?
I just have the one trap, but I'm also good at foraging because of my wanderer feat, so I can collect if the terrain allows me up to five people for fresh food and water.
Great. So you'll totally succeed with that.
Find kind of an open nearby stream.
Grabs water from there.
What
kind of water level are we looking at with the stream? Does it look fishable?
It's pretty low.
Sorry. Oh, okay. Well, I have a fishing rod and such, so I was like, I might be able to find some other food, but.
Yeah, you could definitely try, but you're likely going to be fishing a tiny little fish
that won't probably be much to you.
Fair enough.
But you've only been out searching for water, you do definitely find quite a few good berries and that sort of thing.
That's bonus.
You get back to your trap.
There's a deer.
So there you go.
I'll finish off the deer and I'll tie that up with some more rope, and I will drag that back and reset the trap.
Okay.
So you head back. Berries and deer.
Berries, deer, and water.
Sounds pretty good to me.
Where are you heading to the tavern?
Yeah, because that's where I told them I'd meet up with them. So I'm just gonna drag my deer.
Just dragging deer into the tavern. Blood.
I got deer.
Well, I'll leave it outside. Like, I'm not gonna drag it right in, but I'm gonna drag it like up to the front door or whatever. Yeah.
Tie it up so it doesn't run away.
Despite the anguish of this healing kit out there trying to revive.
I'm assuming there might be someone in here who can cook it. I want the hide. I can help skin it, but there's no point in skinning it right now if I'm not gonna get to cook it, so.
All right, so you leave it outside the door.
We could probably skin it up between the two of us and skin it pretty quick and have it in the back ready for the feast tonight.
There's a feast tonight?
Oh, by the way, the thorn is a feast tonight.
Surprise!
Hey!
Well, yeah, if you want to help me skin it, yeah, sure. I'm up for a feast.
Sure, this will help.
Should make
my mug.
It smells worse than two. Oh, it smells worse than taste. It's really not that bad.
Here, take this. I want to look at this because I don't know. I don't trust him. I mean, I do. He's my leader, but I don't know. People don't share alcohol where I come from. Not openly like that.
And I run off.
And that.
Flee.
So, sludge. Does it look somewhat appetizing? I don't know what to roll for that, but I want to roll something for that.
I don't know. Wisdom or intelligence.
It'll have to be intelligence.
Better. All right.
17.
Okay.
So looking at this nice
deep, dark, brownish, red, chunky, thick, kind of liquid.
Take a couple sniffs of it.
You're pretty sure that this is a great liquor, might not taste fantastic, but maybe after a little bit of refinement it might not be too bad. Definitely not for everybody. Yeah, it's definitely drinkable.
Well, I'm just gonna slam it back then. We're like,
slamming back a cup of maple syrup. You kind of get like one big wave and it slowly just drenches into your mouth after you've consumed your globules, you taste the alcohol, you taste the tangy, and then as you swallow this syrupy liquid, you just go,
I'm drunk.
It just kind of hits you all in one moment.
You go numb.
Yeah, yeah, you're pretty numb. This stuff is potent.
I'm gonna look at Maple and look at my unfinished traits, look at her again, look at mine, and I'm just gonna grab mine, chuck mine, like as if, you know,
I was gonna drink it all.
Yeah, just waiting for you. Right, similar thing, an initial kind of grit, and then it slowly trickles into your mouth after. You kind of drink your drink, and then you are.
Let's go see the deer! Choppy choppy!
Also, hand actions.
I don't think I have a
medium and large dagger. And if I find Helen, she has my small dagger. Bitch goes in with a long sword, and I gave her a dagger. Yeah.
If people aren't too picky, I just skin it with a great axe. Don't ruin the hide.
I can use that
just
for something. They're handy and they sell for lots if you do it right. I have a rabbit pelt still. Remember? I've done this before.
Alias and Pythagoras, what would you guys like to do?
This is two drunk barbarians are gonna go out and skin a deer. I just got there enough to slam a drink and walk back out.
Do we have Helen in the room with us?
Or no, actually, the location.
Well, I'm gonna walk around the village, try and find her, go to some people I know.
Did I notice anybody in particular with her? You know the people that were out there. I'll just go to their house.
See if she's conscious in any way, shape, or form.
You see their small little house door shut. You can see some light coming through one of the windows.
Knock, knock.
Timothy, and it's the wife of the guy who was carrying her, and she goes, I meant to say, sorry for not doing so. I just wanted to check on our friend Helen, see how she's doing. Mind if I come in?
No, she lets you in the hall.
She lets you in the hall. It's a small kind of room.
Does she look conscious at all, or is she just like PTFO?
She's lying on her back.
She's actually awake. She's asleep. Cool. I'll walk over, see if she reacts to me walking up next to her. Yeah, you walk over, and she just kind of slowly turns and looks at you.
And just kind of stares at you for a couple moments, and then puts her head back the other way.
What did you expect?
Not you.
I'll pull up a chair then.
How are you feeling, Helen?
Not ignoring me. She doesn't respond at all.
Cool. I'll just hang out for a bit.
Assuming I don't get pestered.
Yeah. I'll be at the tavern.
I'm just gonna have a couple sips,
like very small sips of that drink, and work on my rapier. I'll just keep drinking it.
Okay.
All right. What percentage would you say that's at? The rapier.
I would say you're probably close to like
85, kind of thing.
You're getting better at doing it as well. So, you're getting faster at it. Nice. All right, guys. So, Helen has no reaction to you after using half an hour or so. You know what? I'll head back to the tavern.
Where everyone else is, and once I'm back there, I'll ask the two barbarians slash Maple because it's her slide.
We want to bring Helen back to the tavern.
Just in case she tries to wander off on her own or anything like that.
We can get some answers out of her and some direction of what the heck we should do next.
Yes, absolutely. I don't assume we'd be very far into skinning this thing, so I'll help unload the sled there, so you can take it over to Helen.
And hopefully she's up and at it soon.
Because if I remember correctly, we have to get you to the tower pretty quick here.
How are you feeling, by the way?
Are things good so far?
I think so.
As far as everything we've gone through, you know.
Oh yeah.
I feel as I would expect.
Your shoulder holding though.
Definitely.
What's left of it?
I don't feel it.
Well, make sure you do let us know if you are starting to feel, you know, that barbarian's brew holds some of that mud together.
Oh, that would probably burn a bit, but maybe not.
Couldn't make it worse.
Just start stirring and bestirring. Once we get that unloaded, I'll go back in the tavern and I'm gonna go find our fearless leader. I mean, like, are we staying here the night? Because if so, we need to. I need to put my bags somewhere. I'm just yelling. I'm drunk.
Keep your voice down. Yeah, I figured we'd stay another night.
By the time we feast, have some meal, whatnot. Yeah, we'll need to have.
Once we're done here.
Do we have rooms already?
I'm sure they'll be accommodating. But the guy went to sleep, so I don't know. I guess we can just help ourselves. We kind of saved the whole town.
I'm just gonna pass you my stuff and run back. I'm gonna go skin a deer. Here.
Okay.
I'll grab my knives and such, and yeah, my whetstone so I can sharpen the knives as we go, and my flask of water. I'm gonna go tie up a deer in the back, Skaticus. Let's do this, or Elvagar, I guess. Sorry, not Skaticus.
It's like, who I thought I was going to help you. All of a sudden, this guy, like, freaking, you know, half-elf ranger shows up.
You summoned me from the other dimension. I'm here to skin the deer.
He do it with his bow, all right. Too.
Alright. Next to Sand, come and help.
Alright, so you're gonna grab Helen.
So you head back there with the sled.
So you head back there with the sled. By the time you get there, she's sitting on the edge of the bed. She goes, she says, what could you possibly want? Harry? Did I not make it clear that I didn't want to talk to you?
Oh, you did, but I think we have
more things to discuss.
More things to discuss. You should come back to the tavern with us.
What do we possibly have to discuss?
I want to know a little bit more about what went on there.
Why am I here? What did I see?
I'm sure I don't know.
Meaning of life.
She says, but food sounds nice.
She stands up.
I'll just sigh.
And pick up the sled.
All right.
And she is while limping, moving along with UK pace.
She's somewhat mobile.
And you guys get back to the tavern. Shortly after, you can see.
Wow, I almost said Nexus and Scotticus.
You see Almagar and Maples finishing up skinning a deer.
They seem to be pretty agile at it.
Although
they seem to be giggling a lot while doing it, wholeheartedly convinced that
it's going that well, but it's quick.
out of curiosity, what kind of deer was this? Was it a male or a female?
Female. We can't get into the glands, because if you do that, you ruin the meat, and the smell is atrocious.
Dear Alvagar says, drunk Alvagar is like,
poke those, they blow up!
No.
Okay, so you guys finish up skinning the deer. Helen and Elis are back. So you guys, I'm assuming, are all kind of back to the tavern. You said you were going to bring the deer into the back so that they could be prepared for the feast as well.
By this point, John Tane has come downstairs and he's in the back of the kitchen as you bring the deer back.
He goes,
Oh, thank you. This is quite kind. Did you just get this today?
This would be very fresh if so.
Just what I think, there's nothing else you could possibly do for us.
You keep providing. Well, thank you.
There's some berries around here too.
Promise you.
As she says that, I come into the kitchen.
Oh.
I'm bored! Can I help you cook?
This work is fully beneath you, but okay.
You just get in there. Yeah, sure.
All right, so you help John Tane prepare the feast.
A couple other people come in as well, and they are also kind of assisting him in the kitchen. You guys are making quick work of what looks and smells.
The rest of you guys, I want to still keep the deer carcass, but just the skin. What I can get, basically, I want to see if I can get a few pieces of it. I want the tail, what I can of the hide, and the skull and mantle of the deer, I guess.
You manage reasonably well.
You wouldn't be able to sell this high.
To a tanner or something. But it's okay.
It's more for personal use.
So it'll be fine. But yeah, you managed to get
the tail to hide in the all the parts that you want.
Cool. Okay, that's all.
So you guys are at the tavern.
Pythagoras is in the back cooking food.
Three of you were sitting there with Helen. She's just sitting there picking at your guys' plate, just eating from it.
I'm gonna grab a chair and just pull myself right up to the most available space, and I'm just gonna start eating because I am fucking hungry. And I'm probably still kind of gross too, but I did try to clean up a little bit. That's why I had the water with me when I went to go skin. But you know, I'm a barbarian. I'm only so clean.
All the wet stuff's off your hands, right? As long as that's gone.
Besides, I think half of us are still covered in our own blood to begin with, so you know.
Yeah, you guys are looking still very battered and bruised from the events of the night before. But Helen's sitting there eating her food.
Kind of glances at three deers in the back now.
Awkward.
She says, all right.
Just start asking the questions. I know you have them.
No?
Is there anything you can actually just tell us about the people who occupy the tower? Like, these type of people, where do they come from?
So I'm trying to think of a better way to ask. So you're wondering if they're from different lands or if they're all local to that area?
Yeah, I assume from what you've told us so far that people with these magical abilities basically come to the tower, they're brought to the tower. But how far is the reach? I mean,
there must be other towers.
That do the same thing.
She responds with, "The reach is as far as it needs to go. Essentially, they will travel across the entire land to find someone if they need to.
Whether or not they get to them first is really what the determinant of who they end up with.
So there's more than one, at least different groups that take advantage.
There are four towers, and they all seek the same people.
But not all part of the same group, right?
So while not overly aggressive to each other, they certainly have different beliefs and methodologies in the way that magic is utilized, and because of this, they each try and grab new initiates, especially since people born with magical abilities are so rare, they become even more important to become.
So obviously, the people we were just fighting, are they from a different tower then?
Or are they just a complete group of... Well, there's what I know, and then there's what I can theorize for you.
So which would you like to hear?
Hey, I'm all down for theories.
What I know is that they were certainly worshippers of some sort of cult worshipping the god Fike here.
What I theorize is that these cultists, maybe fanatics, trying to bring back one of the old two towers.
There used to be six, and two of them were destroyed in a war that many have forgotten and many know
you know, falsehoods about.
They were destroyed.
But they were destroyed, and that tower specifically
was
the Black Tower of Fight Here.
So they could just be
cultists gathering on an old sacred ground that they have deemed.
But I'm convinced
the man leading the ritual was a Kaidang.
Which worries me. Because there's not been a Kaidang of Fight Here.
Since those
about 5,000,
which was about 5,000 years ago.
I'm not theorizing, but my village, my family, all them had a very similar fate to this village.
This village got unlucky compared to mine. So that's why I'm just curious if it's possible these people were responsible for my village as well.
Of course, I can't imagine, but
you didn't know that, but.
For what we had seen down there, I pray that is not the case.
Mm-hmm.
So if he was a Kaidang, does he need a Kaidang to be near him at all times?
Or are they able to separate?
So the bond between a Kaidang is only dependent for the Kaidang. So the way this works is the ritual they're both raised up in, they need to essentially accomplish this internally together. If they fail, one of them will die, but a Kaidang cannot exist without a Kaidang. And the reason for this is that what gives them their abilities is the fact that they are bonded to and can siphon energy essentially from the Kaidang.
Whereas the Kaidang doesn't take anything from the Kaidang or rely on the Kaidang in any way.
It's just that it's convenient to have someone around who is essentially a mage killer to protect you from other mages.
We are trained in the ways of anti-magic, essentially.
We are all about quick and efficient ways to kill other Kaidang.
While we are great protectors of relatives as well, other beings as well, that is our purpose.
Now, it hasn't really been necessary for thousands of years, but it is still a tradition.
So, the purpose of your tower, what would you say? Are they protectors, or are they? I'm just trying to figure out who these people are, what they stand for, basically.
That's a difficult, I can imagine.
I'll tell you this.
I am from the White Towers, you know. The White Tower was at one point the greatest of the towers prior to. They were the ones that gathered the lions of the towers to destroy the other two. Past that, though, I would ask that you restrict all judgments to the time.
Fair enough.
I would like to believe that there are towers, the goodly one.
Some dark.
I would like to roll to make my specialty pie in the kitchen.
All right, specialty pie by pie.
So let's see, dexterity, you said dexterity or whatever, right?
I said you just essentially take whatever your best skill is and you'll find a good
an acrobatic pie.
Makes it while doing backflips.
At least you have real berries to put in it.
16. Yeah, I'll use the berries, and I'll put it, like, just a small drop of that nasty booze in it, too. So it's because of syrup. I mean, that works.
You know what? While they're in the middle of cooking at some point, just because I'm still wasted, I'm going to walk back into the kitchen, and I'm just going to hand Pythagoras my pouch of cooking herbs that I have. Here you go!
I'm just going to dump all the shit in the pie now.
I'm just going to walk out. I said at some point you might
awesome
have.
It'd
be awesome if you got a mix up where cooking herbs. Shoving like cooking herbs in someone's wound.
I had a pouch of cooking herbs and a pouch of healing herbs.
John Tane
looks at the pie and looks to you and says, "May I?" He like points his finger out at it.
What do you want to do?
Just wish to take a small sample.
Slap his hand.
Small piece.
Of course, go ahead.
I'm sorry, I didn't.
So he puts his finger in. Like
so he puts the, his finger in like one of the openings in the crust.
Is there nothing you are not talented at?
This is magnificent.
Yes, it's an old recipe passed down through the generations of the Ellert family. It's quite well known, actually. I just kind of do one of those, like, prideful things.
Santhi herself could not have made a better pie.
Ah. Sure to think your last name is Armstrong.
The Armstrong!
Yeah. Added down to the generations!
Down through the family lines of generations.
All right, so...
The day is getting on.
You guys are having conversations. Things are smelling very, very good out of the back of the kitchen. You're also noticing that the village has come to life a little bit as the days progress. Everybody probably went to their home hid for a bit, but you're starting to hear a little bit of talking outside. And looking through the tavern windows, you actually see that people are setting up little posts that have these little, like, flags and ribbons hanging from them and stuff. So, you know, they're getting ready for kind of a little party. In fact, some of the decorations they're putting up outside, you'll remember from the last town, Crowsmill, that you had stayed the longest in. So clearly it must be a cultural thing of some kind, because there's a lot of very similar reminiscent sort of items being placed up.
I'm gonna go and ask the innkeeper if there's a room we can go to clean up.
Just in the hustle of trying to get the feast done. I was so tired. I didn't even show you rooms. Yes, of course. You'll each have my finest rooms, and each of those have a bathing basin in them. I'll have someone bring up some hot water for your basin immediately.
So he leads you up to the room that he's giving you, and he says,
I pray it's sufficient if your comrades are in the rooms next to you down the hall.
That's fine.
Yes. All right. Perfect. I'm used to sleeping outside.
You can show them the next four rooms down this hall shall be for you and your companions.
Yes, I cannot stress how much we deeply appreciate everything you've done.
They'll have hot water up here for you momentarily, and he's like scurries back down the stairs to the common room.
Yeah, awesome. Well, I'm gonna go try and clean up a little bit, and yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't take you too long.
They bring in pitchers and hot water and they dump it into the basin. They're pretty efficient. Before long, you have kind of a tub to do some cleaning. Awesome. Very nice room. Kind of a bed, nice sheets, you got your own little table, window to the outside that kind of overlooks the forest and surrounds the town. Is this in like one level, or do we got to go upstairs or something for this?
It is up one, so it is the top level, but it is the second level.
Alright, well, I'm gonna do that for a bit.
I'm just gonna clean up and like trim my beard a bit and whatnot, just to, you know, get ready for the sort of party for me and whatnot.
Alright, so anybody that wants to clean up,
they'll bring hot water up for you and that sort of thing.
Before you guys leave,
Helen is going to ask, like, is there anything else you wish to know, or perhaps we could talk later.
Oh shoot, yeah. I guess before I do that, I'll be like, yeah, let's talk. Does Helen have a...
Does Helen have a room too?
Yes, they did. I'll let Taryn say, why did you want us to leave you back in the dungeon?
Why didn't you want to try and make it out?
You already know the answer to that.
I don't want to see what she says.
How I see it, either way, I'm dead.
And I would have rather died fighting for a cause than be executed by my peers.
Well, if we all head back to the tower, you don't think we'll be able to fight for you and build a case?
While I appreciate the notion, no.
They will kill me upon arrival.
And I had some time to think as I slept through the night.
And I was debating running, but honestly, I think I will accompany you,
and I will meet my fate there.
So that is why.
All right.
We'll see what we can do when we get to the tower then. With that, I'll go upstairs and ask one of the wandering handmaidens for some linens or something, so I can try and bandage up my shoulder. Before I tear up their night sheets.
I guess once I'm done cooking, I'll go up and clean up. When I do though, I'm like, kind of smell myself. I'm like, God, what? And I'll have that moment of clarity and be like, oh, deal! And I'll start looking for my mouse. Is he there or is he dead?
Reach in your armor, this thing will just mush. It's probably Maggie, you've fallen on him too many times during battles. You know, several blows that hit your armor have crushed him over time.
Even the maggots have maggots.
I'm gonna try and cast mending on it.
Nothing happens. It might smell a little worse now. In fact,
all right, you open up the window and just, oh man.
All right, so you all get cleaned up. You take your time. Is there anything else you wanted to talk to Helen about?
Before I wash the blood writing off my face.
Is it like in common, or is it like weird?
Some kind of runes.
Can I look around the room? I don't know how well I can see my reflection, but...
There's actually a mirror in here.
Is there a mirror in there? Oh, cool.
I'm going to look around the room to see if there's anything I can try and write it down with, just off of my face.
Yeah, sure. Give me an intelligence check, please.
Okay.
The one for the future reference, the one beside the 19. I can remember that.
I've never seen
Unlooked Face like that before.
Okay, so yeah, you try your best.
Cool. Fold that up and tuck it in somewhere.
Fold that up and tuck it in somewhere.
Wash it off. Yeah. All right.
Wash it off.
See, as it cleaned out, the day progresses.
See, as it cleaned out, the day progresses. It gets a little bit in the evening. The sun is setting again. It's mid-fall at the moment, right? So, the sun sets a little bit later.
Girl's feeling a little bit colder outside.
Girl's feeling a little bit colder outside.
Tonight's nice night, nonetheless. From your windows, you can see down below. From your windows, you can see down below in the square.
Many, many people have gathered. Probably almost the entirety of the village.
And there are people kind of setting up.
There are people kind of setting up.
Stave area.
Children are running around.
People wearing their normal clothes.
Not covered in blood and such.
It's a completely different place than it was a day ago.
Well, let's pack up and leave.
This only gets so good.
So you guys are all gonna head down then?
Yeah, well I'm gonna head down.
I got a spell called prestidigitation. I hate that fucking name. Anyway,
I know.
I'm gonna cast it because it can cast up to 3 times and it lasts an hour, and it has a whole bunch of different fucking effects that you can do. So, I'm gonna use it on bottle of booze that I have. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to cast an illusionary image of something inside the bottle. It's going to be like kind of like a reptile eye, but it's like crystal.
Okay.
And I can flavor anything I want as well. So I'm going to make it taste pristine.
Okay. All right.
Maybe like water or something. No. Just something sweet. Something that go with the pie.
Sure.
Okay.
I can also make like a like a symbol or a mark. So there's gonna be a picture of Almagar's face on the front, just kind of like Steve-O, like. And then I'll go downstairs.
Ah, barbarian's brew. Okay. All right, that's awesome.
Okay, and Maple, you're gonna head down as well.
Yeah.
So the four of you go downstairs.
So the four of you go downstairs.
I'm gonna bring my drum though.
See what's going down there.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah. Okay. Right. Cool.
Are you guys going down like armed?
Are you guys going down like armed and armed and such, or are you? I don't actually wear armor.
But I'm still gonna have my my daggers and my short sword. I don't know what. Yeah, short sword. But I'm not gonna have my spears with me.
Okay.
But yeah, I'll still have some stuff with me. But
sure.
Yeah.
Are you kind of in the same boat?
I'm gonna go with everything.
Yeah.
And I'll leave. Like my backpack in my room. Like I'm not carrying everything with me.
I didn't write down what it has in it, but I have a disguise kit. Is there like noble clothes or something like that in there? I don't remember.
Yeah, that works.
Yeah, if you want to dress like more noble, then definitely.
I'm gonna try to hide the great axe, obviously, kind of put it between the fur and the chain.
I'm gonna try to look and dress down and not so scary.
Nope, never mind. Scary. I'm just proficient with it. I don't have one, so I'll just wear some regular clothes.
Okay.
I have great cloaks. Want a cloak?
No, I'm gonna wear my skin cloaker. That's what I'll wear.
Nice.
What?
Big black leathery cloak. Okay, so the four of you meet downstairs. And there are several people in the tavern.
Not sitting and drinking or anything else at this point. It looks like they're getting ready. People bring food outside. You're starting to get nice smells and aromas.
Bring big plates out to a long table they've set up. It looks like everybody's going to sit at one table. Which is something that you may or may not have seen in the past.
Certainly seems to be typical for that.
And there's enough conditions that sort of thing. Servers already out there. So you guys are in the tavern.
Okay.
I'm gonna head out and start mingling.
Yeah, I'll head out as well.
I'll sit down and.
And is Helen down here with us?
She's not.
I'll help set up the table and stuff in the tavern.
I'm gonna rip to Helen's room just to see if she's gonna join us.
Because
the people obviously overheard a great deal of things as well.
Sure. Okay. So, as you go up,
I'm gonna yell at you. I'm like, you better make sure she comes down here. It's her feast too. But I'm not going up. I just yell that at you.
Alright, so you head upstairs, her door is shut, and I've heard the occasional, like, thud from inside her.
I'll just give it a bit of a light nod.
She says, yes, enter.
So I'll poke my head in and...
So you walk in, immediately what you see is, she looks like she's made an effort. Up a little bit as well.
She's actually got armor on.
She's wearing a full kind of chainmail suit of armor. She's got a longsword of some type at her hip.
And she's currently throwing a tabard over her chest piece.
And the tabard looks like this shield with a lightning across the front of it.
Would I recognize that symbol?
Yeah, you would. It's one of the more common gods. It is the symbol of Onassia.
Onassia is kind of like the mother of gods, but she's deemed one of the most powerful.
She's kind of one of the original. She's a main primary god.
Okay. Sir Nerf, I was just gonna make sure you were gonna come join us for the feast tonight.
Yes, I plan to. I'm far too hungry now. She laughs.
And she looks like Spritz, her shoulders are dislocated.
Yeah, she needs some help. That's why it looks like she was kind of half struggling with the tabard on, but she manages.
She doesn't look like she's comfortable while doing it, but she manages.
So you've come a long way since the helpless villager we found when we first met.
Yes, well, I suppose I've been more vulnerable.
Oh, I only wish you'd come with us.
We hadn't talked to it in the first place down into the caves.
But again, we thought you would just hold us back because you're just helpless and, you know, show us.
That's all right. If the rest of you hadn't been there,
I wouldn't have gotten as far as I had regardless. So you can't give me that much credit.
She says, yeah, so I will be downstairs.
We'll meet you outside.
All right, I'll head down.
So the four of you head outside. So the four of you head outside, and Pytan are going to help set up the table out there. John Tain is just like, you're just so helpful.
You really don't need to do the common folks' work.
This is a nice celebration for you. But who am I to tell you not to help?
Sorry.
And as soon as he opens up the doors from the common room in the tavern, everybody kind of looks to see who's coming out, and they all kind of stop what they're doing to start clapping for you.
And a
and a few like cheers and that sort of thing, and like a bunch of thank you kind of raining out from the crowd of people, and they just like keep going for a good solid five here. Before John Chain's kind of like, okay, let them pass, let them through, let them sit down, and thank them all you need to later. And everybody kind of slowly dies down and they clap, clapping, and then start going back to the tasks they were doing before.
Guess I'll head over to the table and
Helen comes down before long. You guys can see her in the armor I described to Scott there. So full chainmail, she has a tie over her head, long sword at her side, she grabs a seat at the table beside you there. And soon enough, it looks like almost everything is out, set up, and they've got like a pig on a roast in the background, that sort of thing, where they're bringing out things from the kitchen. And they set up a bunch of like various meats and fruits, that sort of thing, all along the main table. And everybody kind of grabs a seat. Everybody's trying to get as close to you guys as possible. So the table fills from wherever you guys sat, like outwards. See, there's never no reward in my campaign. It's just rare. It feels so much better, doesn't it? So at the far end of the table, as everybody's sitting down, John Tane puts his hands in the air.
Quiet down, everyone.
Everyone kind of comes to a hush. He raises a glass.
I don't know what more I can really say.
I'm not quite one for words.
But know that
you will never be forgotten here.
Ever. There's no way.
There's no way. Stories will be told to our children and our children's children and their children's children.
Of the heroism and self-sacrifice
that you did for no other reason than to save our lives. We are deeply, deeply grateful.
We do wish that there was
more we could do for you. I hope that you accept this humble feast as a sign.
To
the heroes of Bre'ak.
Everybody cheers and claps,
and then all of a sudden somebody starts playing some music in the background, and it gets all merry, and everyone's talking, and everybody's reaching for food, and yeah. And it's a good time. It gets a little bit darker, and the torches, there's like torches lit kind of all over the place, so it keeps the area nice and lit. There's children playing around the poles with the ribbons, and there's people dancing and songs, and awesome. So you start playing the drum, and you're just feeling so good, you just naturally fall into the beat of the music, and yeah, it's...
Once people start getting a little more drunk, I'm gonna pull up that bottle, like... Gather around, everyone. I have a special treat for everyone. And I have my pie there too, if they haven't eaten all of it. But once they all gather around, be like, I made something special for everyone here. It's called Barbarian's Brew, and I show them the picture of Almagar's face.
That's me.
I know that barbarian.
This booze is instilled with a crystallized eye of a wormling dragon. It will give you the strength of 10 men, or the strength of a dragon. Normally $200 a bottle, but I'm willing to give everyone one cup for one gold.
Because this village is just overflowing with gold.
So everyone was like clambering around while you were describing it, and then as soon as you mentioned the one gold per cup, they're all just like, back off and go back to their.
I'm only kidding. Here, have some.
And they all crowd back in. So you just kind of like pour it as they come line up, kind of thing. Right. So the look on people's faces as you pour it are kind of like as it like slurps out of the bottle. But then they smell it. Then they give it a taste. First guy says, "This is the best brew I've ever had. I do feel like I'm as strong as a dragon." And then everybody's like really interested. And you burn through that bottle quick.
And after an hour, does the brew turn back to what it really was? And all of a sudden, everyone's on the ground like.
Well, people as they take chugs of this stuff are already walking away like.
Damn, I thought I'd swindle these people.
Yeah.
Maybe in a city where they actually gold.
I've seen a gold piece once in my life, sir.
What's this city called?
Bre'ak. Village.
Okay. Village of Bre'ak.
Man, I'm horrible at taking notes. My page to mess, I'm like,
yeah,
what?
All right, so there's much merrymaking, and your stories are told of ancient times. Some of them sound quite outlandish, others maybe a little more realistic. Songs and tales are told of them. It seems like a lot of people know these tales. They must be told quite commonly around the realm. As many people film words and sing along.
I want to take a look. What are people's reactions to Helen? She was just a villager like them, and now all of a sudden she's fully.
When she sat down at the table, you're thinking about it. You're not sure anybody even recognized who she was when she originally sat down. And it's not until, because before she was very meek looking and she had like her hair tied back like a working woman and that kind of thing. And now she's just like
full force kind of thing.
More of a warrior type persona. And it's not until you guys mention her name or somebody says something to her that others around her are like,
God, that's Helen.
And then people seem to be kind of thankful to her or treating her like a bit of a pariah. Only because they don't understand why a villager Helen is all of a sudden this person.
So one story comes up that is particularly interesting.
Only because it kind of relates back to what Helen is talking about to you.
And it's a story about someone called Keldar Blightsbane.
And Keldar was this guy who, following the hundred-year war between the Kaidame,
sanctioned a new order. And this order's purpose was to essentially police magic going.
And while most people are talking about magic stories, they don't truly grasp, again, this is a land you guys have to do all the time where magic is just not a common thing. It's an abstract concept, it's like space kind of thing, but how many people truly understand it is very, very limited.
So they're telling these stories, and every time magic comes up, it's like more of a magic, dark one, this evil thing.
And then this Keldar Blightsbane guy comes along, and after the wars, he's going to ensure that those wars never happen ever again.
And he's going to police magic and make sure that magic users don't get online. He's seen as this great hero to the
team. The person probably takes it too far.
So that's kind of the story. It's a very positive thing about how he walked to the White Tower and upon the White Tower's doorstep sat for 40 days until they granted him an audience. And when they did, he walked in and told them essentially how it was, the new edicts of the land. And if they didn't like it, the people themselves would rise up to slay them. And everybody's like, yeah!
I'm just gonna take a look at Helen.
She's just staying there. So that's kind of the flavor of a lot of stories. Others are much more lighthearted. A dragon named Dread, and how he only had one wing, sideways, and those kind of stories about mythical beasts. So this continues on. Lots of music. Lots of people come. Thank you guys. You do get offers for I don't have much, but here's some coin. And in most cases, it's just like a couple coppers or at most like a silver. But they seem to be genuinely doing what they can to kind of thank you. And somebody comes up to you, Pythagoras, and says, she's like,
petting her stomach.
Petting her stomach, and she says,
"Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. About to bring a new lad into this world.
I would never have happened.
I would like to name him Pythagoras, if that's all right by you.
That's fine. Sure."
She says, "Oh, thank you."
She gives you like this hug.
Congratulations.
She like stamp. There's other people coming up to you, Maple and Almagar. Teach me how to be a barbarian. They're like, let me see your axe. And how did you kill all the dark ones? And all this kind of stuff. You're already noticing that the stories for over time must really be diluted because your guys' story is already becoming a very diluted mess. It's like, you guys went into this dark tower to slay a cultist of dark ones, and it's more or less true, but then they get into how nasty it was on your side, the very hand of Onassia guided you to slay all of the people in the tower that worship fight here, and all this stuff, and no one mentions the Kai name at all because you guys kicked ass, which is great for the story, but it does kind of show how much these people are putting you guys up on a pedestal, which is awesome. So after a long night of drinking, eating, and being thanked and given coin, everybody seems to kind of calm down and go to sleep.
If they don't end up around, you guys probably determine, unless there's something you guys like to do, to head back to the rest before you depart.
Nope, going to sleep.
I'm actually going to go back and check my one hunting trap that I reset after I caught the deer. And if there's... Well, we'll see. That's what I want to do.
I think I'll go with Maple. We'll go take a look at that trap. I'm gonna check to see if I see a sneaky person lurking in the shadows.
Look for an old friend.
All right, you can give me three perception checks. Each of you can.
Wait, all of us are just two.
Okay.
Six. 16, 15, and 9.
So you don't notice anybody lurking necessarily.
But you do definitely see
something else in the way of the trap.
So Bre'ak is surrounded.
Bre'ak is surrounded by forests. There's a tree line around. To the north, there's a little bit more of a gap in the field area before the tree line started again.
Not even maybe 400 paces away.
400 paces away.
Is that guy again?
Wearing the gray cloak.
And it's ruffling in the wind.
It's ruffling in the wind. He's just standing there staring.
He's kind of on the edge of the tree line.
Like, is this the guy I saw in the forest?
That made you. Is this the guy that made you do something to your?
I'm gonna stop Elmagar. Like, just like, whoa. Like, I can't even be subtle about this. Well, I don't think barbarians are subtle about anything, but.
Punch. Just whack in the face. Okay, I'll stop.
And I'll just be like, over by the tree line there, about 400 paces. That's the guy. From the
other. That made you stab your dog? That made you stab your dog?
That one, yeah.
I hate to be the one to run away, but we run away.
How close are we to my hunting trap? Is that like?
Oh, pretty close. The hunting trap.
The hunting trap was on the western side of the forest line. So you guys were kind of moving northwestish, west on the road towards the tree line on the west hand side of the village. But you can see across the northern fields from that road, and that's where you're seeing.
I'm still going to go to the hunting trap and see if there's anything there, but I think this is something we should report back to the guys.
Definitely. Go ahead. Unless you want to run back now. Well, I'm not going to leave you up here by yourself with this guy.
I'll kind of ping back just behind her
while she goes and checks the trap, and then.
All right. So the trap caught a very poor and unsuspecting heavy rabbit enough to depress the trap. And it was just like,
there's a very large bat.
I'll make sure it's stabbed and finish her off. And then I'm going to reset the trap. I'll grab it again before we leave in the morning. But I'll go bring this back to the inn and then, yeah.
And as you guys are dealing with the trap,
you can see the man just kind of turn around and go back into the...
Yeah, that's something I'm still, like, as I'm just kind of, like, trying to ignore it, but I'm just like, oh my god, I'm gonna die. He's gonna do so. Like, I'm totally uneasy about all of this.
See, now you have someone to stab. Right, if you don't have your dog, I guess.
I'll even look at you, Albagar. I'm like, this is why I wanted my weapon silvered. I knew he was still around.
That's a good idea. We definitely need to find silver. Is Jordan trying to join us or is
he? I think he might just be coming in to listen.
Oh, okay. I'll just have that. His name is
So he goes back to the tavern, and at this point, you head back to the tavern. Tavern. Okay, so you guys head back to your rooms, and
have a good night's rest.
I give the rabbit to the innkeeper. I'm like, yeah, for breakfast.
You have to thank your generosity. Breakfast is prepared, including some meat, along with strange hot water beverages with crushed leaves sitting.
Could I roll some sort of thing to figure out what it is?
Yeah, sure. Just intelligence.
Eleven.
So I'll leave this one up to you. Tea isn't super common because it's, not used, but you might have this in your past.
This is too runny.
So I take it after an hour, my picture's disappeared off the bottle.
Oh yeah.
It's back to sludgy sludger. Okay. So you guys, I'm assuming, eat some food, drink maybe a little
tea. And I'm gonna ramble off after we get some food and tea in us about, last night it was that guy again. I think he's stalking us or something. The one in the woods that I told you about by the farm that we think is the lead vampire.
Was that the guy that was at the ritual site where we went to go save that kid?
No.
Nor had to wipe my blood on the thing to get in.
Could have been you too.
No, that was a different guy.
Antimaeus threw a dagger through his face, I think, and it went right through. I don't know if that was the same guy, though.
No, that was a different guy. That was just, I don't know, some guy at the tower opening. I don't know who he was, but this other guy was the one that you know, I said I had that episode, and he compelled me to stab Chief.
Oh, right. Guy compelled you.
You guys made a lot of weird guys.
What was he doing?
He was off to the north edge of the forest. He just was watching. So we finished grabbing the rabbit and out of the trap, and he just went back in. Didn't do anything.
Is that the direction we're going? North?
Is Helen down here?
Sorry, the tower.
Yeah,
the tower is north.
Is Helen down
there
with us?
She is, yeah.
I'll turn to her and say, does any of this sound familiar to you, Helen?
No, I'm sorry.
Doesn't sound like anyone from the tower.
Many strange people and strange creatures that exist in this area. So we might have a vampire after us. Or at least, that's what we concluded he was. We don't really know.
He said he was a vampire?
That's what the tanner in the other crow mill?
Man, I missed a lot of stuff.
Said. Yeah, well, I've been a little paranoid about this guy. I don't like this guy. He gave me the creeps, man.
By the way, Alias, are you a ghost? I've been meaning to ask you for a while.
No.
He's brought back. He's alive.
There was this weird thing that happened a couple days ago, and
you
saw the little girl
before we entered the forest.
Yeah.
We all saw the little girl. That's why we didn't go.
No. It came out of his face, and she was like,
yeah.
I can't can't remember what she said though. Some
she just like smiled. I think. She just smiled at us, right?
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. You saw that too. I'm gonna get really uncomfortable.
did she say anything or do anything?
I think she just said hello. It freaked me out, so I thought I was just tired. but then I thought Alias was a ghost.
Making those comments. Okay.
Well, I feel better now about that. Sort of. At least you're not a ghost.
Nervous
well,
chuckle.
We've gone almost a full day without someone trying to kill us, so I think we're due. We're past due.
Yeah, one night without a death. Okay, so... So you guys eat your food, drink some tea, and get prepared to leave.
I'd like to see if anyone has some healer kits I could get off of them before we go.
Maybe
if yeah, I was thinking the same too.
Hey, how much money did those villagers give us?
All in all, you made 25
silver. Woo! That's something.
Hey, we have a real fruit again.
They both like, I was going to draw.
And my face.
If you mean someone in the group got loot, then yes. That would be wrong. Okay. So you guys get ready to depart. You ask if there's any healer's kits or anything else that people can provide you. They gather enough supplies for you. Well, they don't have a ton. Enough to give you five charges of essentially equivalent items to healer's kits.
That's damn good. Better than I expected.
Is there armory or supplies left in town?
There is. There definitely is.
Oh, maybe we can see if we can sell some of our weapons to them. We don't need to carry all of these. Unless you want to take them to the tower. I mean, do you want another great axe? Before we leave, guys! Helen, do you guys need stuff? We got some armor and stuff here. Before we go and sell it, maybe we should see if anyone wants it first.
Get your hero's weapons in.
Well, by the look of Helen's get up, I don't think she needs one.
Thank you.
Okay, well, I'm going to take the spears.
Any daggers?
No.
No, I'm good then.
There's some long swords.
Sure, I'll take one of those.
Take one of those? Got some great cloaks, a black leather armor, 6 chainmail.
If you don't mind, can I keep that ornate sword that we got off that captain guy? I'll keep that on me.
I think we should get that looked at.
Yes.
But yes, you can keep it on you.
Probably at the tower, I would assume, since it was one of their
can Helen look at it? I'm gonna scratch that out of here, so you might want to write that down.
And
so there's some chainmail, some shields, and some great axes.
That was a lot of
A pair of boots. They're just a pair of leather boots. They're really nice.
Helen,
Okay, well, then we'll go to the armory or blacksmith, and we'll see if we can sell some of this off, and I need some bolts.
Okay.
Right now.
Okay, so you see kind of a hefty man throwing his hammer against what appears to be a horseshoe on it. He's working away, and as he sees you approach, he puts the horseshoe aside and kind of wipes his hands off the rag and says,
Hello.
I did not mean to ignore you with your long.
No, just watch it.
Excellent. For the town's saviors, I would not wish to insult. You also notice that this guy doesn't quite fit in with most of the villagers here, so in this area, a little northern province, everybody has quite pale skin and fair hair, maybe some deep brown. This guy has kind of a deep tan on his skin, and he's also got dark hair.
Do you deal with weapons very much here?
Do you mean crafting them? Not often, but I do possess the skill to acquire such a thing.
We have a few weapons here. I don't know if you'd be interested, but we've come across quite a few weapons in the last few days. Obviously, may I see? Of course.
Grab the weapon, but I could certainly use metal. I'd be willing to pay you, but I can't determine the fair number.
Do you have any hand axes?
Yes. Wow. Mainly used for the hatchet. They're well balanced and used in martial situations. Equally well, in my opinion. They just don't look quite as nice.
And I would assume if I do not have any silver on hand.
I'm trying to find some silver.
How about a small hammer? Would you have a hammer here that we might be able to purchase as well?
Yes, of course. I craft all my own tools, so I have one.
And what about a shovel? We're going to be needing one of those.
Yes, I could buy those as well.
Awesome.
Do you have any hunting knives?
Yes, I do have those as well. So yes, I can provide you with many of those. If these are the type of items you see, perhaps I can buy them.
Does that include like the armor too? In that? Okay.
Yeah, for everything you present.
I think that's fine. We don't need this.
Sounds good to me. I'll get like a hand axe and hunting knife.
Alright, cool. So if you guys are okay with that, I'll hand over a couch of points. I'll give you hand axe, shovel, hunting dagger, and anything else. Or the hammer. Kind of mundane like that. And yeah, they'll take all the weapons and armor that Locker has and say, thank you, pleasure.
In that case.
This might be far-fetched, but do you have any like sewing needles here by any chance? I'm looking for like particular like thicker needles to like go through
hives. Yes. In that case, I don't have precision, but yes.
Bolts.
Ah, yeah. And a crossbow.
Bolts. Unfortunately, no, I do not have any bolts of that type. Not something conquested. And really only have one. Anything else?
Is there a stonemason in town somewhere?
There are those that work in nearby, but none have the gift of the Lord. I take it we're not going to run to the first carpentry at the moment until we kind of finish up the tower, maybe. I've still got nothing to carry with you.
Yeah, fair enough.
Those hand axes, I'm gonna say, could I have the one? Two more of those?
Grab two more.
Thank you.
You are more than welcome, my fine friends. Anything for you that I can mention. Else
you know, I'm going to take him up on a little dagger, take a knife or whatever.
Yep.
Stick it in my pocket. Not really, because that would
hurt. Maybe we could make you a little sheath for it under some deer hide.
I have a rabbit pelt.
Alright, so is there anything else you guys like from this guy? Or are you, Okay. All right, so he thanks you again, and goes back to his work, and you gather what you had been given by him, and you prepare to leave. Is there anything else you'd like to accomplish in Bre'ak before you leave this village? It is a 2-10-day journey to get to the tower.
Probably get some rations or some type of...
I can forage, but... Yeah, as you were walking back from the blacksmith, the innkeep approaches you and says, Here, again, for all your travels, the least we can do, I dried some of the meats that were left over from last night, and I prepared them in ration packages for you, so hopefully this should keep you for your journey, at least to the tower. And he presents you guys with enough, a hefty amount of food, like enough to get you to the tower easy. He goes, Thank you again. Please, pass through Bre'ak once again. We would love to see each of you. I'm sure we'll be back through here at some point.
Well, you know, if you're interested, we have a cart back on the other road just outside. If you guys, it's fair game.
I appreciate it. Do you mean down the kind of rugged path on the eastern road?
Yeah, the one you wouldn't think you would bring a cart to.
Yes. We may avoid going that direction for quite some time, but I appreciate you letting us know. Perhaps in time we will venture back there to go grab the cart and return it to its owner's hands in the future. One last trouble. I will bother you. I do apologize for taking so much of your time. We would like to make yesterday a day of celebration every year, and we were thinking of names, but something like Liberation Day just doesn't sound quite as nice to hear as potentially something else. I was wondering if such brave adventures, you are the ones who made it possible. Would you like to name such a day?
Pie party.
Pie party.
Annual pie party.
That's pretty good.
Here, here.
Sure,
yeah, pie party.
Pie party day. 20 years later, it's like, how do you celebrate pie party? Because guys, it's the harvest.
Yeah, exactly. We're celebrating the harvest.
And we make
it with the next. He goes, yes, that is wonderful. The pie you made yesterday was so incredible that it's just your name. It all fits so well.
I'll make an attempt to show up every year to make you guys a pie.
He wells up.
And,
Please don't trouble yourself too much to do that, but I do have a favor to ask. Yes, anything at all.
I was wondering if I could get two tombstones commissioned for some heroes that fell while we were trying to save the village.
We did not even need to ask us. Yes, of course. What would the names be?
The first would be Jojo.
Okay.
And that tombstone, I wanted to read something specific, if that's okay.
Yes. Sorry, give me one moment. He pulls out this little scrap that's clearly not written on. He grabs it and then he's like, okay.
Jojo, squire to Pythagoras, Matthias, Alistair, Elric. Second greatest hero in all the lands.
Second greatest hero?
Well, I'm the greatest, of course.
Oh, yes. Sorry. I thought you meant, no, I understand that. All right. Yeah, he roughly etches this on his little scrap paper with his dirty rock. Yeah, I'll remember. Dirty rock. All right, and what is the second one?
The other one would read Chief.
Mastiff Chief.
Mastiff Chief? Okay. And what would you like to say? If any.
His spirit has found its new place.
Love. You should become a poet after you have done adventuring. All right, so he takes it, looks at it, and goes, ah, yes, I will.
Thank you very much.
You are welcome. Yes, we will place them among the most noble people that have lived here.
Excellent.
And I'm going to go back and go collect my hunting trap before we leave.
All right, so you go and click on the trap.
And I want to take a moment after I collect it to see if there's guy in the woods at all.
This fucking thing is insane. I would have gone to myself. I would have been like, April! Could you come with me?
No luck with the trap, unfortunately, today. But no man in the woods.
Okay.
He's stuck in the trap.
He's backing away.
Standing there like he doesn't care, his ankles in the trap, and then all of a sudden after moments of staring. Okay, could you give me out of this thing?
Why don't you just compel her to, you know?
All right, so you guys depart and start on your journey north. Is there anything you'd like to accomplish over this travel period?
I'd like to work on my rapier as usual.
Okay. Anything else?
I want to spend time and even maybe even get Helen's attention when it's convenient at like camp settings and all that. See if she knows anything, maybe if she will have a look at this book I got. Because I'm going to spend time looking at it. Because it has runes and such, and I'll even ask Alias. So there's like, I don't know, you died. Can you read this?
Can you learn any languages?
I don't know how it works. You shouldn't be here. That's all I know.
Do they look familiar to what was written on my face at all?
Somewhat,
yeah. And Helen will say, the runes in this book appear to be of a very, very ancient language. While I cannot read it, there might be those who can at the tower.
I'm gonna try to find along the way, like some animals or like shed somewhere along the path or something. So I want to make a nice little handle for my hunting knife out of the bone.
Yeah, sure. Okay.
I have a deer skull.
Can I attempt to make some arrows along the way?
Yeah, big job.
Do I need to like roll something for that? I don't know how that works.
The only thing will be like the arrowheads, but
fair enough.
Attempt to make some little makeshift, so yeah, for sure.
Cool.
They'll be like probably closer to like sharpened stone or like sharpened kind of arrows, but you know, better than nothing.
Cool.
Yeah. Okay. So you give me intelligence. Algar, I'll get you to make a survival. You don't have survival, but wisdom check.
I'll try again later, too. I just get frustrated and throw my handful of pebbles into the floor. give me one of them.
Okay, 15.
A few days pass, and you eventually rake through the forest to the other side. And what's in front of you are just kind of rolling fields of gold, essentially. What would normally be green grass is instead tall kind of yellow grass on either side of the main road. And the sun of midday full sun reflects almost off this gold and makes the whole area glow. Far in the distance, you can see the tower once again. You're a little bit higher elevation than the flat level that it's on, and you can also see the mountain range kind of close around it, and the huge bay of water that the city at the base of the tower borders. So it looks like a long journey, obviously. Hitting things in 2-10 days, but you're now So you guys continue traveling along, working on your specific tasks, and probably chatting and sharing stories, that sort of thing.
Okay, so you guys continue on your journey, kind of going through a few of the rolling hills that are in front of you, and come across a small bridge.
And on this bridge...
What is your favorite color?
What is your name? What is the air? What is the air? Velocity of an unnamed swallow.
So good.
Anyway.
And you see a couple of guards standing on the bridge.
And they are wearing the same or similar armor to Helen.
It's more so like leather, but they're wearing the same kind of tabard that has the shield with the lightning bolt on it. And they step in front of the bridge.
And say, halt! No one can pass.
They just stand there.
Okay, I'll turn around.
Well, I guess we can.
Glance over to Helen, and then look at them.
Helen will step forward and say, "This bridge has never been before. Been lost. Why now?"
And they kind of give her, some squinty eyes, and they go,
None of your business,
Kai Dan.
You move along now.
You don't need to return to the tower.
This bridge is going over a river?
It's not a huge river, it's not a high current, but it's fairly deep. It's not really violent or anything. You could definitely wade your way across it, wouldn't be an issue, but you'd be slow moving through it. Let me just stand there.
Well, fearless leader, you want to talk to these guys?
Well, Ellen can't get across.
How are you noticed something?
Under the bridge. Slowly being pulled along in the stream.
See his foot dangling out.
And I just kind of noticed that these guys then go.
All right, I understand. Your business is very important. I'll tell you what.
Grease our palms a little,
and we'll let you pass.
How about
20 gold pieces?
I am going to ask who that is under the bridge.
My guy goes.
Oh, no one.
Just a transgressor who tried to cross the bridge earlier.
Didn't have enough gold.
Didn't refuse to pay.
I want to do an insight check on these guys. Are they actually guards? Or do these just look like some thugs who found some armor?
As will I.
One of them you're not really sure, but the other one, just like eyes starting back and forth, 20 gold pieces, you're getting the vibe, no problem.
considering we have slaughtered countless, unnumbered, in just the last couple days, I can't imagine that the two of you could stand up to us. I mean, really, you should pay us 20 gold to not just kill you.
Elmagar, I know he's very bloodthirsty. Tell you what, we'll give you the money. Just, here. And I'm gonna cast that fucking spell.
Prestidigitation.
That one. And make it seem like I have 20 gold in my hand when I open
it. I can't remember anyone's name in this game, but I can say Prestidigitation.
Almagar, can you give me an intimidation roll? If you don't have intimidation, give me a charisma.
Oh no, I have intimidation. A little bit. 14.
They look at you and
Pius. No. We didn't mean anything.
You go, you pass.
No big deal.
We get.
How kind of you. Thank you.
Yeah, no worries.
Now, Pi, did you already cast that?
I think I was about to.
I was gonna say we could, since you're so understanding, we'll just give you some fake gold, that's possible.
And what's carved into its back?
I miss you.
All right, so you guys are just gonna funnel across then?
I'm not gonna go right down under the bridge, I'm gonna take a little bit closer.
That was my cup apparently crossed my mic, but it scared the hell out of me. Anyways,
If I go kind of to the side, not like going down to the river, but if I go off a bit of an angle as we approach the bridge, would I see more of the body?
Yeah, for sure. So as you're crossing the bridge, you kind of look behind, and it looks like two people are kind of under the bridge, and they're stuck on the kind of rocks that seem to be underneath the bridge. They look like they were just kind of tossed there, but they've been stripped down.
Do these look like your people, Helen? They're obviously wearing their armor.
So you'll notice at this point that Helen is actually taking up the rear in the path on the bridge here. And as you guys are kind of crossing, right as she gets behind these guys, you hear this. She turns around and she just thrusts her sword through the back of the one guy's neck.
Oh, we're doing this? Okay.
And the other guy doesn't suspect anything, so you guys can all take an action if you so wish to.
I think Helen's got this. I think these are Helen's people. I mean, if it was me, I'd want to. so I'll basically have my great axe at the ready, but I'm just gonna stand because obviously I think Helen's got this.
No 22.
Yeah, I'm just gonna be like, you do you.
22 and 20.
Did you say?
Oh my goodness!
All right, all those were hits.
Fuck. 4 damage.
7 damage.
All right, so stab and spear just thud into this guy, and he's just and he collapses forward dead.
And Helen goes and casually wipes off her sword in the grass.
She's it, and walks across.
I'm gonna take his armor.
So it is chainmail armor.
You sold some of that.
Now, I was going to say this belongs. I don't know. Like, I'll ask Helen, should this stuff be returned to the tower, or should we do something with the bodies?
Maybe not these bodies, but those bodies.
The bodies are with Onassia now. There's no need to do anything with their mortal remains. As far as the armor,
take it.
Just don't wear the symbol, I would recommend.
Do they have anything on them besides that?
They each got a long sword.
They each have a spear, and then total, they have eight silver.
Eight silver?
And 15 silver.
And 24
copper.
Oh man, so if we put it in the band, they would have really made their fortune.
All right, so you guys continue on. So you continue to travel.
The nights and days pass. It's becoming much cooler, especially as you approach this further. And especially as you get closer to the ocean, you're starting to get the smell of kind of the sea. And you're also starting to hear sea kind of bearing sort of thing.
So you start to hear the gulls of the city.
So it's almost been the full 10 days of travel, and you're on your last day. For the record, you were successful in making eight arrows.
Almagar, you were definitely able to find a way to whittle it into what you wanted to be your knife there.
Okay. It got whittled, but it got crafted. I thought it was big enough, like I would use a knife too. you know, it doesn't need a whole. It doesn't need a whole lot of work. Just more so, just get it fit properly. And
the next time we have downtime,
the next time we have downtime or as we're traveling, I would like to just ask Helen if there's anything else we should know, like what to expect when we arrive or anything. And obviously, I'm sure they're not going to be too welcoming. But are there any
anything like
not to say we should go on one knee, but is there any procedure or protocol that we need to know?
Understand that they don't typically have audiences with people. We will certainly have one due to our circumstance, but this isn't normal, so please just act with respect and do whatever they say. It's really of the utmost importance. If they ask you to kneel, kneel. If they don't stand, if you don't speak unless they ask you a question, so on and so forth.
The ritual.
Yeah.
Sorry, I was going to say, the ritual you performed on me, is there a special name to go with it? Or if we get separated?
But it's also not really supposed to be even spoken of outside of our circles. And as much as I've done it to you, I don't think it's even part of our people. So I apologize.
All right. If I call it the bonding ritual,
they'll know what you're speaking of. Yes. Cool. That's sufficient.
Debonding.
All right. So you approach the city bordering this gulf or this bay.
A city.
It's quite large and
long, I guess,
for lack of a better term. So the bay kind of loops in like a U, right?
And the city kind of is around the border of the base of this U.
And then it comes back up, and the tower is at like kind of the top right tip of said U, with the mountains kind of backing in.
Approaching the city are these large white walls.
Probably the largest you have ever seen, depending on where you've been in the past. 30 feet tall, man guards up on the top. You can actually see they have what appear to be like a ballista up on the walls as well. So heavily fortified. They look like they've seen
their share of battles. There are many of the bricks that appear to be partially
broken.
But none of it feels unstable.
Still feels like a very solid wall. Something to defend itself without question.
So Helen leads you to the primary gate, and
it's open.
And as she walks through, the guards kind of put a hand to their heart and give her a little nod, and she does the same to them.
And do the guards have the same tavern? They do, yeah. As you walk in, everyone, even on the walls, they all have the exact same tavern. As you walk in the city, it's an immediate kind of hustle and bustle. There's people everywhere. They all look like they're going about their daily tasks. Many people walking through with large fishing nets with fish and that sort of thing. Even from the entrance of the city, because of the way it is, and it's fairly thin.
You're in the road, you have a clear sight to the docks, like at the end of this road. But Helen takes you off to the right to continue kind of around the base of the U of this city, up to the tower. And as you're being led through, the people here are certainly different than what you've maybe experienced.
This far north, if there's somebody not wearing a large pelt or padded clothes or tubble wrapped up in several coats, it's unusual.
Their faces are kind of a little more grimier, not necessarily unhappy, but just worked. And they look like they've all seen many days, for lack of a better term. Even the young look like they've seen a lot in this world. As you get closer to the tower, there's an inner wall that, while not as high as the outer wall, is still as magnificent and actually in much better shape. Engraved on the wall on opposite sides of the gate are the symbols of this shield with the lightning bolt through it. This portcullis on the gate, however, is closed. And Helen walks up to a man near the gate, has a quick discussion with him. And she's essentially told to wait here. And the man goes in through one of the doors in the wall, and then departs.
So the four of you were left standing there for quite some time.
Or I guess the five of you.
Are left standing there for quite some time. And after probably about half an hour or so passes. A troop of ten people are walking towards the gate outside the gate. The portcullis slowly opens.
And they approach you.
There's one leading with the front.
And he looks Helen up and down.
And says to her, Not the circumstances I expect you to return under. Yes, well planned, don't always go to plan. And he says, you know what this means, right?
She says, yes, of course I do.
He looks over her shoulder.
And says, which of them?
And she points back at you.
Hi.
And then points to you, Amelia, and says, that's the other one.
The ten men walk towards you guys, and they kind of walk on either side of you in a file.
And the man at the front says, follow us. And assuming you do, they are going to escort you through the portcullis. This path continues on quite a ways, still curving up towards the tower.
You go through no less than two more gates before you arrive at the central courtyard of the tower.
In here, you can see many people that look a lot more proficient than even Helen, just standing guard.
And beside them are people in robes and other people moving above the guard that just have kind of power emanating from them.
They remind you of the two people that you met on the path that one day, as well as the girl that you had met back at Curl Mill. None of them seem to pay much attention to you until they see Helen. And then they kind of all give you strange glares, and some are even shaking their heads. You're brought to the base of white marble stairs,
and the man at the front says, wait here.
He walks up the stairs, talks to another guard, and these huge double doors, again made of some kind of white material, open at the base of this tower,
and he motions for rescue to come up.
Do you?
Yeah. Come this far.
Yeah, I'll go slowly, though. I'm a little reserved about this.
All the chicken scenery out while we're going. Impressive.
It's very white.
We'll be the most magnificent thing I've seen as far as structures or whatever.
They bring you to the tower.
You're in yet another main hall. Even more of these people are wandering around through there, all giving you strange glances.
There's a small set of white marble stairs that lead up to another large door,
which gets open and you're led through.
Into an even more massive chamber.
This chamber at the far end has four white seats. Two at the front are kind of elevated above the two at the sides. And you're brought into the center of this room. On the floor of this room is again the symbol of the shield and lightning bolt. You're kind of standing right in the center of it.
It looks above you like there are multiple levels that people can almost stand on balconies.
And it looks like there are chairs in said kind of slots in the balconies. So this appears to almost be like maybe a council chamber in other days.
But for now, there's only the four empty chairs at the front. The man says, wait here.
And he says, Helen, step forward.
And she steps forward closer to the chairs.
After waiting a little while, in funnel four.
There are two women and two men. One man and one woman sit at the forefront, and one man and one woman sit at the side chairs as well. And they stare at each of you to describe these four people.
Two of them are wearing robes, which are the two at the front.
And the two at each side are wearing a full set of glimmering plate mail.
While all of them look to experience a lot, they don't seem an age any more than maybe 30 years old.
But they kind of have this ageless look to their eyes,
as if that's probably not likely to reveal the real age that they are. They stare at all of you, and then one finally breaks the sentence, or
breaks the silence,
and says,
So,
you have come to be, judged,
and judged you shall be.
And
the other says,
Helen,
we have assessed your crime,
and as per our laws, you will be sentenced to death.
And Helen just gives them a quick nod.
And two men come up.
They rip the tabard from her armor.
And they put cuffs on her hands.
And she just kind of looks back at you guys and says,
"Thank you."
And they take her over to the side of the hall.
And she's kind of standing there for 2 hours.
She looks to Alias.
Now you two step forward.
Okay.
I will step forward.
Okay. The hardened man sitting beside the woman appears to be a Kaidan. The man, likely her Kaidan, steps up,
walks over.
He gets within inches of each of their faces,
and just stares.
He has deep gray eyes.
He sees a scar right across his face, very fine. And he also has many other scars. He has a little bit of gray in his hair,
and a little bit of his beard as well.
After kind of inspecting you guys for a few minutes,
he says, "We have judgments for each of you too." Looks to you, Alias,
and says,
"What are we being judged for?" I don't understand what's going on. Who are you people? Why is she dying? What's with your face?
He looks back at you, and then looks back at Helen. And just shakes his head. Before finishing his sentence, he actually just turns around at this point and walks back up the stairs to sit in his chair.
They stay silent
for a few more moments, almost as if they're
in any other situation of a council,
they'd be talking at this point. But they're all just kind of sitting there blankly staring at you.
I am so confused. Are you guys confused? I'm confused.
I thought they were supposed to help us.
Why are we being judged? Are they all mute except for you?
The front two.
and look each other and nod.
And the female says,
"There is but one recourse for this defiance to our people
and for this disgraceful act.
Death.
You shall each be sentenced to death."
And then guards approach.
And they will attempt.
Whoa.
No.
That's where we're calling.